Good afternoon to all the respected participants. I welcome you all to the fifth day of the national webinar on world literature. Today we have with us our esteemed speaker of the day, Professor Indranil Acharjo. I'd also like to welcome my dear colleague and head of the Faculty of Arts, Communication and Indic Studies, Professor Kalyani Samant Rai, and request her to chair the session. Madam, the stage is yours. Ma'am, you have to unmute. Yeah.
Thank you, Rindan. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A very warm welcome to the final and the apex session of our webinar series on world literature. I'm honored to present today's speaker before you, illustrious Professor Indranil Acharya, who works with the Department of English, Vidyasagar University, West Bengal, and who chaired the department previously. It's a pleasure to announce his glorious contributions to academics and to a special cause, the cause of the indigenous ethnic communities in India. He completed two UGC projects as the principal investigator on Australian and Indian indigenous traditions in 2008 and 2015, respectively. Professor Acharya had been the deputy coordinator of the UGC SAP program in the Department of English from 2009 to 2014, and the state coordinator of the People's Linguistic Survey of India since 2009. He worked on the documentation and translation of the oral and folk literature of Dalit and tribal communities in West Bengal. Professor Acharya has also completed one UGC innovative research project in 2017 on the endangered tribal languages of South Bengal districts. He's received special mention from the president of Sahitya Academy for his excellent contribution to the People's Linguistic Survey of India, West Bengal chapter. Apart from his research in the area of Dalit and tribal communities, their languages, their cultural ethos, their performances, Professor Acharya has also authored, edited, and translated several books which have been published by different illustrious publishers like Oxford University Press, Odin Black Swan, and Sahitya Academy, including the other publishers. Now I request Professor Indranil Acharya to give his talk on Australian Aboriginal writings and Indian Indigenous literature, a study in the context of endangerment. Professor Acharya, a very hearty welcome to you to this session, and we look forward to listening to your erudite scholarship.
Thank you, Professor Samant Rai. It's really my privilege to have received an invitation from Sri Sri University to deliver a lecture on a topic that we had been engaged in through our research activities over the last 12 to 13 years in our department at Vidyasagar University. I would like to congratulate the department here, the center which has organized this webinar series, and also the Vice Chancellor, President, and all the administrative heads of Sri Sri University. Jai Gurudev. Am I audible to all of you? Hello? Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, Indranil. Yes.
Yes. Okay. So it's always a pleasure for me to associate myself with the activities of Sri Sri Ravi Shankar Ji. Because I had been associated with some of his activities in Midnapur district, especially in Midnapur town, way back in 2008-09, when I joined Vidyasagar University. And I had been personally benefited by various activities and innovative ideas which had been floated by Gurudev during his visit to Midnapur in 2009. So it's always a very special kind of feeling for me when I get the opportunity to address the fraternity here at Sri Sri University. And I hope that I would be able to put across the course of research which we had been pursuing in our university department for the last 12 to 13 years. As you can see from the title of my presentation, Australian Aboriginal Writings and Indian Indigenous Literature, a study in the context of endangerment. In fact, when I began one UGC minor research project way back in 2007, it was on the documentation and analysis of Australian Aboriginal writings, contemporary Australian Aboriginal writings. And as I finished that project in 2008, I realized that it had many resonances with Indian indigenous literature, particularly the tribal writings of different regions of the Indian subcontinent. And as you know that there had been many biological researches into the ontology of the Australian Aborigines. And we find that there had been several genomic studies, genome mapping research, and many of them have indicated that Australian Aborigines have their lineage way back to the African continent, that is almost 75,000 years ago when the migration began for the first time. And they also owe their origin to Southeast Asia and South Asia particularly. And there had been other geological theories as well, which try to explain the large scale migration of these Aboriginal tribes, these indigenous populations from Asia to Australia, as several plate movements, tectonic plate movements. And we know how these theories are there, available in various scholarly works. So when we think of the tribal population in the heartland of the Indian subcontinent, particularly the central and the western part in the Chotanagpur area specifically. Now we find that the major dominant tribal groups of the Chotanagpur district are known as the Austroasiatic tribes or Austric tribes. In fact, there had been some newspaper reports published in early 2001, 2002 in the Statesman, the Times of India, and other leading newspapers, which highlighted some research findings conducted in the research institutes in UK and USA, which identified genetic similarities between the Aboriginal tribes of Australia and these Austroasiatic tribes of the Chotanagpur Plateau. So in a way, we find that there had been some vital organic connections between the Aborigines, the indigenous communities of Australia, and the indigenous communities of the Indian heartland. In fact, the Chotanagpur province of India. And we have found that there had been many migrations, there had been many cultural migrations, and in a way, many of the characteristic features of their cultural life had been found to be similar in both the continents. And as a result of that, when I finished my survey of contemporary Australian writing, Aboriginal writing, I decided to take up a close comparative study of Australian indigenous writings and Indian indigenous literature. And that was the beginning of our UGC SAP program, the first phase in 2009, No, when we applied for the documentation, translation and analysis of the Dalit and tribal literature, oral and written literature of the Dalit and tribal population of the Eastern India. And during our course of research, it had always been my particular interest in instituting a kind of comparatist framework between the two continental varieties of writing and their points of convergences and divergences. And in a way, I have found during my research that there it's a worthwhile area of research, worthy to take up for maybe the future generation of researchers who could provide more time in some dedicated understanding of the two continental varieties of writing. In fact, we should come to the next slide, nomenclature, where Indigenous Australians we find refer to themselves with many terms like autochthons, like natives, aborigines, okay, and indigenous. Anyway, the most used term is aboriginal because of the shared history and national political solidarity. You know that there had been a general, often disparaging, contemptuous nomenclature, the use of the word aborigine by the white Australians, where they are often disparagingly called as abos. And it has a shared history of pain and suffering, of insult and humiliation. And in a way, this disparaging treatment consolidated the position of the Aborigines. It inspired them to unite. It inspired them to consolidate their position of political resistance. So from that point of view, Aboriginal is an overtly political term, which has helped the people, the indigenous population, indigenous groups of Australia to unite. But the term is also objected by many of them, as it had been imposed by the British colonizers, okay, the mission of Captain Cook and the descendants of Captain Cook. And it obscures the diversity of indigenous cultures, obviously, because Aboriginal is almost an attempt to homogenize and standardize the sheer diversity of indigenous cultures that is prevalent in Australia. And it can't distinguish from the other parts of the world, that is indigenous populations from other parts of the world. So we find that there are many Aboriginal authors and scholars who prefer their nomenclature in terms of language groups and also in identifying their regional group identities. And anyway, indigenous is the most neutral term, as people belonging to a particular place, rooted in a particular place, and native of a particular place. So I have also tried to, in the next slide, what is a minor literature. I have referred to a groundbreaking research article by two French philosophers, Deleuze and Guattari, way back in 1975. But I have found that this essay, What is a Minor Literature, and the Characteristics of Minor Literature, and an Analysis of the Minor Literary Communities by Deleuze and Guattari, can well be applied to an understanding of Australian Aboriginal writings, particularly if you read Deleuze and Deleuze's ideas on minority culture. Okay, you would find that there is a reference, in fact, to Australian Aboriginal writing, Australian Aboriginal English, and the problem of cultural representation on the part of the Australian Aboriginal groups. Deleuze defines a minor literature, minor as from the point of view of minority, because you know that in the white Australia, the Aboriginal communities are regarded as minorities, and they are excluded from the white racist discourse of Australian mainstream. And in a way, as Deleuze and Guattari state there in that essay, that it mediates the minority group within a major language and society. So in Australia, the Australian English the major language and the white Australian society, the major society, somehow, you know, the minority group has to mediate between the dominant culture and their marginalized position. So it's a process of continuous, in a way, you know, deterritorialization and reterritorialization of their cultural writings, of their cultural representations, not merely through the form of writings, but also through many oral representations. As you know, the indigenous cultures, you know, ancient indigenous cultures had always been predominantly oral by nature. And the second element which Dulles and Guattari have been highlighting in their essay is that of the political element, the connection of the individual to the political immediacy of the situation, of the culture, of the dominant culture. In fact, if you look at, you know, Australian Aboriginal writing, you would find that there is an urge on the part of the individual author to reassert the political necessity of his or her writing, because, you know, the political representation is also a kind of attempt to reclaim the position of power and authority. It's also an attempt to reestablish the issue of identity, you know, the cultural identity, to reclaim cultural identity. So political element is another important aspect in all Aboriginal writings, in all indigenous writings, and that can also be found and discovered in the context of Indian indigenous writings as well. And the third very important aspect that Dulles and Guattari highlight is that of collective value. Okay, it's always a kind of, you know, communitarian writing where there is a collective enunciation of their cultural position. And in a way, as we also find in Indian Dalit writing, Dalits who are also part of Indian indigenous population, now we find in Dalit writing that the autobiographies are not merely the life stories of the particular author. Okay, it's also the record of an entire community. It's also a narrative of the pain and suffering of the entire community. So any, you know, indigenous writing from that point of view has a collective value because it represents the experience, the entire spectrum of experiences of the entire community. Okay, so these are some of the aspects which we find in the minority position of the Australian Aboriginal writings. And as I have already mentioned, that I have wanted to look at the discourse of, you know, endangerment, the social, political, cultural, linguistic, religious, you know, realities of endangerment. As I want to look at the context of endangerment, you know, I have definitely, you know, I have definitely attempted to look at the issue of endangerment from the theory of this marginality, the theory of minor literature, the theory of minority community, okay, who are aspiring to represent themselves through their writings. In the next slide, the Australian Aboriginal situation, if we look at it, why is it endangered? No, if you look at one report published in The Guardian, okay, as late as on 21st March 2014, you would find that there had been another, you know, renewed attempt on the part of the Australian government to revive the policy of the stolen generations. And there had been a renewed attempt to abduct the Aboriginal children from their home and from their parents. And it's such a sad story of, you know, forcible, you know, snatching away of the Aboriginal children from their parents, and in a way forcibly, you know, entering them into missionary schools, and thereby in a way uprooting them from their own culture, and to make them, you know, decentered, to make them rootless. So even that practice is being renewed in 2014. And all the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people are endangered from that point of view, because their oral cultures are dying out, because their performances, their religious festivals, different customs and rituals, okay, and which are essentially embodied and emplaced form of knowledge, okay, those forms of knowledge are fast dying out because of sheer negligence and non-recognition. I move on to the next slide, the threatened oral tradition. No, in continuation of the previous slide. In fact, we know that for the oral tradition to survive, there should always be two generations. The learning generation, that is the younger generation, and the teaching generation, the older generation. And the learning generation should be in direct physical proximity to the teaching generation. But the entire, you know, tragic phenomenon of stolen generations, where one generation of children was forcibly taken away from their Aboriginal cultural habitats, we find that there was a kind of gap, there was a void, a cultural void, and it blocked the possibilities of a direct continuous flow of knowledge, of traditional knowledge system from the teaching generation to the learning generation. In fact, if we look at the history of the Aboriginal experience of marginalization, we find that it all began with the arrival of the British at Sydney Cove in 1788. And all of us know that history, okay, that that cruel, you know, event of death, displacement, and severe cultural disruption to the Aborigines. How the white settlers, you know, mostly the convicts who came from Britain, okay, ultimately displaced the Aborigines and killed many of them, and launched a regime, a reign of terror, a regime of massacre and mayhem, okay, throughout the Sydney province, the eastern province of Australia. And there were severe cultural disruption. The white landholders drove out the Aborigines, okay, and they lost their own land. Okay, and then came the missionaries who banned traditional languages and ceremonies. Okay, so we find that how, in a way, the Aborigines could not, you know, retain their own land. They were not allowed to continue their own language, their own ceremonies, and how there was a kind of slavery which was forced upon them by the white convict settlers. Okay, and it was a case of wrong which they couldn't even present as a case of wrong. They couldn't reclaim their land rights, you know, because of this, you know, typical Western system of knowledge, okay, the typical, you know, compulsion to produce written evidences. And as they did not belong to the mainstream written culture, you know, they couldn't prove their claim to their own land. And in the next slide, the crisis of indigenous knowledge system that I have here recorded in this slide, the indigenous knowledge system was completely destroyed by the British. In fact, there were various interesting cultural practices, the signifying systems like sand drawings, body scars, paintings or carvings. In fact, in Odisha, we find sand drawings have assumed great artistic proportion. You know, the sand paintings of Sudarshan Mahapatra, okay, are already, you know, a great work of art. You know, similarly, the Australian Aborigines were past masters in sand drawings, you know, body scars, you know, tattoos of different designs, paintings or carvings as forms of folk writing. Okay, all these indigenous practices, signifying systems, were ruthlessly ignored by the white settlers. Orality was considered backward, as it happened also in the Indian context. Okay, that was considered to be primitive and ignorant, and the secret domains of knowledge were not respected. They were deliberately disrespected. And the tradition and modernity, that conflict was there. In fact, we find that when there was a problem, when the traditional oral regulative system of the indigenous people, indigenous groups, you know, comes in contact with the print and electronic communication technology. Because later there had been, you know, some attempts to record and archive the traditional oral, you know, cultural system of the Aboriginal people. But what happened that the technology which was used by, you know, the white Australian people, okay, changed the content and disrupted the original customs, okay, and their flavor, their essence, to a large extent. In fact, media could not, you know, appropriately capture the cultural nuances of the indigenous peoples. And the dialogic transactions of, you know, the indigenous cultural performances, okay, were ignored. And the non-verbal communication systems were excluded. And the performer audience dynamics, okay, was completely absent in the digital transformation. In fact, similar things happened also in the Indian indigenous and folk literary context, performance contexts. We find that the performer audience dynamics, which we often find in our ancient palagans and jatrapalas, okay, can never be actually translated into any other form, into any other language, or into any other, you know, multimedia forms of representation. So that is a problem, definitely. And now let us move on to, you know, the first attempts at literary writings, and in fact the anthologies of Australian Aboriginal literature. The first anthology by Catherine Langlaw Parker's Australian Legendary Tales. Once again, these were very sanitized version of the myths, mostly Christianized and full of didacticism, which were absent in the original version. And English translation in alphabetic writing, in a way, distorts the original form and the function of the legendary tales. And the translation was rather merely to recover the inner lost primitive of the Westerners. So the translation was done keeping in mind a kind of, you know, sensationalist practice, whereby it was some kind of a romantic self-association of the Westerners, where they could rediscover their inner lost primitive. And the recent attempts include at translations and anthologies, where we find the dialogue between Aboriginal speaker and person recording the narratives. There is the Aboriginal speaker, the interviewee, and there is one non-Aboriginal interviewer, and orthographies are now being used to represent the words from Aboriginal languages and non-standard English pronunciations. There are some attempts to capture, you know, the original flavor, and we find that instead of these white interventions, there had been another, you know, parallel and maybe more meaningful development on the part of the Australian Aboriginal authors and narrators, okay, who have come upon and who have rather come forward to document their own myths and legends in their own way, you know. And we find such Aboriginal authors and narrators like Paddy Rowe, you know, Gulara Bulu, 1983, then Bentarak Mueke and Rowe, Reading the Country, 1984. And we find that there had been, you know, a few Aboriginal narrators who have attempted to capture the original spirit of performance tradition through their own narratives. And they were published later by some, you know, Aboriginal press. And in 1980s, we find that there had been, for the first time, a fresh interest in the revival of Aboriginal, you know, literary or you know, cultural systems. And Oxford, Collins and Penguin, they had been bringing out Aboriginal oral narratives in the 1980s. But at the same time, there were charges of cultural assimilations into the Western form, that the actual original Aboriginal contents were not retained, and there had been many changes and editings and modifications. And if we look at the facets of endangerment that we have witnessed in Australian Aboriginal society, we find that the earliest Aboriginal writing by Bennelong, it was a very long letter that was, we find in 1796. In 1788, Captain Cook arrived there in New South Wales. It began, and 8 years after the first, landing of the convict settlers, we find in a long letter a record of torture. We find by Bennelong, and Aboriginal people's contributions were not acknowledged, and we find in especially 1815 onwards, the Aboriginal children were stolen. It began the entire process of stealing children from their Aboriginal parents began as early as 1815, and the oppressive school experience for the Aboriginal children was recorded in the earliest writings. The white people stole country and they also stole children. The school imposed cultural assimilation, servilence and a kind of bodily discipline. And there was an organized, orchestrated attempt to induce a sense of cultural amnesia amongst the Aboriginal children who were snatched away from their parents. And the Flinders Island Chronicle, it was the first Aboriginal newspaper about the Aborigines published by the white settlers. And the first Aboriginal newspaper heavily censored to promote Christianity and civilization among the Aborigines, and how English disrupted the orally based Aboriginal gerontocracies, particularly the knowledge retained by the elderly people of the Aboriginal communities, and how elderly wisdom was completely disrupted and ignored. English educated young Aborigines who were educated in the missionary schools, how they became more powerful than the older men. They were given more power by the white Australian government. And as a result of that, the traditional protocols of communication were completely ignored. And the actual indigenous political interests suffered because these, this new generation of Aborigines, young Aborigines, this Huffies, this stolen generation, this half Aborigine, half Australian population, were completely in a way maneuvered and manipulated by the white Australia policy. And we find there were several cases of human rights violation, indigenous human rights violation, Aborigines' rights and freedoms denied, women separated from their children, their letters were intercepted, read and destroyed, and newspapers, letters, and written testimonies were there. And from those, we find the earliest specimen of indigenous literature of the indigenous communities in Australia. In fact, on 1st April 1938, we find the first Aboriginal newsletter was published, the Abo Call, the title of the newsletter. And it was building a kind of national pan-Aboriginal political constituency. Although the Abo Call didn't last long, but it created a kind of shared identity amongst different indigenous communities in Australia. It welded the local and regional Aboriginal groups into national imagined community, if we apply the term from Benedict Anderson, an imagined community, because they were so many, there were so much diversity, and there were so many groups in different islands and different parts of Australia that they could finally be welded as a national imagined community. But even in the mid-1950s, we find the Aboriginal writings were ignored in the high literary genres. Okay, and we find David Unaipan, is the first Aboriginal author who was thoroughly assimilated by the white Australian government, and he was schooled in that missionary school and in a way indoctrinated by the white Australian policy. And his thoroughly Christian autobiography, My Life Story, tells about his own way of you know, growing up in Christian missionary schools, and how, in a way, the White Australia policy shaped his life. We find it from his autobiography, My Life Story. And next, I would move on to Ujjeru. Her Christian name was Kath Walker. Ujjeru was the most representative, you know, Aboriginal author of particularly a woman writer. We should name her first in any discussion of Australian Aboriginal writing. In fact, the contemporary Aboriginal writing, if we look at 1960s onwards, the history of Australian Aboriginal writings, we find that Ujjeru is the most representative voice. And he first worked as a domestic servant and then joined Australian Women's Army Service. We Are Going is a major, the first poetry publication by an Australian Aboriginal woman, published in 1964. And in this anthology, we find poems reiterate the experience of Ujjeru as representative of other Aboriginal people of her clan and other clans. You know, as Aborigines are like foreigners in their own land. Okay, a feeling of being a metoikos, okay, a resident alien, a foreigner in her own land. And like any minor literature, Aboriginal literature of the 1960s and 1970s, okay, was also part of their entry into national politics. Because we find in the similar, almost in the same time, there is the Dalit movement in the Indian context. In the 1960s and 70s, especially in the 1970s with the establishment of Dalit Panthers, we find how Dalit literature was assuming the form of a movement, a literary movement. And in Aboriginal literature also, we find that during 1960s and 1970s, there had been a very prominent way of politicizing their writing. As a means of asserting their rights and reclaiming, rather, as a sustained effort to reclaim their identity, to reclaim their human rights. Ujjeru, Kevin Gilbert, Jack Davis, and Mudruru were the founders of this contemporary trend. In fact, Ujjeru had a very famous utterance. I quote, "Let no one say the past is dead. The past is all about us and within." Okay, so the politics of the core Aboriginal identity, and it had been the White Australian policy to make the new generation of the Aboriginal people, the young Aboriginal people, to forget everything about their past culture and tradition. And state repression was there. Aboriginal demands were for justice, land rights, racist stereotyping, exclusionary models of national identity. And the Aboriginal authors had been continuously attempting to correct the biased historical narratives of progress and peaceful settlement. An illusion had been created by the White Australian administration that there had been no violence, no murder, no massacre of the Aboriginal people. At the time of the first settlement, it had been a peaceful settlement. And as if, Australia was a terra nullius, a land of nobody, and it was later made, terra australis by the white settlers. Okay, as if, Aborigines didn't exist there. Okay, they simply vanished into the ether. So this had been a consistent ploy on the part of the White Australian government, and there was a plea for restoring the continuity of the past and the present. Okay, the new wrongs were perpetrated against the Aborigines, and I have quoted a few lines from a very famous poem of Ujjeru, taken from that anthology We Are Going. Assimilation, no, the title of the poem. Look at the lines, they are self-explanatory. "We must surrender now much that we love, the old freedoms for new masts, your world for ours. Do not ask of us to be deserters, to disown our mother, to change the unchangeable. The gum cannot be trained into an oak." So this is what we find, that how there is an attempt to create an identity crisis and how there had been a spirited resistance on the part of the Aboriginal authors, you know, to overcome that identity crisis, to reiterate their Aboriginal identity with some sense of pride. And look at another poem, Integration, Yes, by Ujjeru. No, look at the realization. Eagerly we must learn to change, learn new needs we never wanted, new compulsions never needed, the price of survival. Yes, indeed, it had been the price, the heavy price of survival. They had to pay a very heavy price only to survive. No, not assimilation, but integration. Not submergence, but our uplifting. So black and white may go forward together. That was the dream of Ujjeru and some other, no, Aboriginal writers. But it had remained a dream. It had not been translated into reality. Anyway, there had been, no, several effects of, you know, colonialism, the white colonialism on Aborigines, their culture and their land. Ujjeru is using white men's language, but she is not thinking white. Okay, and there is a difference between assimilation and appropriation. So we find that despite the white Australian policy of assimilation, the Aborigines have attempted to resist it. And there is always an anxiety of endangerment and extinction. And it has been quite poignantly expressed in her poem. In fact, the title poem of her anthology, these are very famous lines, you know, We Are Going, a very famous poem, okay, which reiterates her inner sense of anxiety of what we should call, you know, extinction, anxiety of endangerment and maybe extinction. The eagle is gone, the emu and the kangaroo are gone from this place. The Bora ring is gone, the Korobori is gone. Bora ring, a very sacred space, okay, a circular sacred space where many initiation ceremonies of Aboriginal communities used to be held. And the Korobori is an Aboriginal religious performance, no, celebration, okay, how the Korobori tradition is dead. Yeah, and we are going, the Aboriginal people are going. So how the entire ecosystem, okay, is endangered. You know, how the non-humans are endangered, how the cultural practices of the humans are endangered, and how the Aborigines themselves are endangered. So there is an oppressive sense of a threat perception, okay, a perception of endangerment. An image of the Bora ring and also an image of the Korobori gathering by the Aboriginal people. And in fact, it's a literature in conflict with the mainstream white Australian policy. Many Aboriginal authors were imprisoned and tortured. Okay, Kevin Gilbert, another prominent Aboriginal author, okay, he wrote a memorable poem, End of Dream Time. Okay, how it suggests, okay, end of the Aboriginal worldview, because dream time is a core philosophical concept of Aboriginal understanding of the universe. Okay, how it establishes a direct and instant contact between the present generation, the living generation, and the ancestors, the dead generations. So the end of dream time also suggests the end of, you know, Aboriginal culture, cultural practices and traditions. And it exposed the historical lie once again of Australia's peaceful settlement in his poem, another poem, you know, very important poem, Memorials. But Aboriginal writing was heavily tampered by the white publishers to suit the white tastes. In fact, it has happened in the case of many Indian indigenous writers as well. For example, Hasda Shobhendra Shekhar, you know, whose writings were heavily edited. You know, the manuscripts were heavily edited by the mainstream editor, the in-house editor of a reputed publishing house. So the state of Aboriginal literature, we find finally by 1993, you know, almost a kind of watershed year, In the Australian Aboriginal writing, also we find it in the Indian Dalit writing. Also, there can be a close parallel where in Bengal we experienced the unfortunate tragic suicide of Chuni Kotal, a Lodha Shabar girl. It belonged to an indigenous community of Bengal, and how, you know, by 1993 the protest movement gained momentum, and in Bengal also we found the establishment of Bangla Dalit Sahitya Sangstha, and how the authors and intellectuals rallied around this unfortunate death of Chuni Kotal. The prison experiences, loss of traditional languages, and pain of stolen children. So in the Australian Aboriginal context, there had been some, you know, recurrent patterns of pain and suffering, you know, of irretrievable losses, okay, from which they were never able to come out. Aboriginal writers could not use 27, you know, local languages of different communities. Only English was permitted. And poets like Lionel Fogarty used the radical Aboriginal form of English, Australian Aboriginal English, a kind of anti-language, okay, as a deliberate, you know, ploy to resist the imposition of a linguistic imperialism. So the new generation Aboriginal poets, we find how they had been attempting to convert the experience of life talking to life writing. And Aboriginal autobiography, okay, like, you know, Latin American autobiographies of Rigoberta Menchú and others, okay, of Indian Dalit autobiographies, Indian tribal autobiographies, okay, autobiographies of the denotified tribes, the nomadic tribes, okay, how Aboriginal autobiographies also developed a new sense of a contested textual territory, how it brought into limelight the experiences of marginalization, and over a period of time, how the long history of exclusion came into prominence through the autobiographical writings by the Aboriginal authors. The women authors, they were very successful, especially Sally Morgan's My Place is a milestone in Australian autobiographical writing, Aboriginal autobiographical writing. In 1987, it was very successful, and it turned the attention of the world to the Australian Aboriginal situation. And it was followed by some other very important autobiographies, Ruby Langford Ginibee's Don't Take Your Love to Town, Glen Eastward's Wandering Girl, and Evelyn Crawford's Over My Tracks. Okay, in fact, I have inserted here another autobiography by Temsula Ao, a Nagamese author. And in fact, if we place the Northeast tribal writing, the indigenous writings of northeastern part of India, we can find a close parallel between the Australian Aboriginal women authors, their autobiographies, and the autobiographies of the northeastern, you know, writers like Temsula Ao. And many others, Easterin Kire, and many others, Jasmine Patton. So I'll be talking about them later as well. Once Upon a Life is also an attempt to capture the experience of being an indigenous person. So Doris Pilkington's and Ruby Lingford Ginibee's, I have also outlined here, listed some very important life writings. And in this connection, I have also mentioned the life writings by the Nagamese authors here, Easterin Kire, A Naga Village Remembered, Battle of British Forces and the Nagas, and how there had been the subjugation by violence, by brutal force of the Naga tribes, the Naga warriors. And in fact, in the domain of fiction as well, we find that Aboriginal authors have reiterated their position of endangerment, of pain and suffering, of humiliation, of exclusion in a very poignant manner. Mudruru's Wildcat Falling is one of the pioneering writings here, 1965, then followed by Monica Clear's Carob Run, published in 1978, Archie Weller's Going Home, and Kim Scott's True Country. And of course, finally, by Alexis Wright's Plains of Promise. These were very important pieces of Aboriginal writings fictional writings with a very threadbare discussion of the sufferings and victimization of the Aboriginal populations in Australia by the White Australian government. And Aboriginal fiction, we find Mudruru developed the genre of historical fiction in Australian Aboriginal writing, and he corrected the myth of peaceful settlement. And if you read the Wildcat series, you will find how Mudruru alludes to the sufferings of different Aboriginal communities, different groups like Eora, Dharug and Tharawal, who were vanquished by the British invasion in Sydney region. And later, Melissa Lukashenko's Steam Pigs also talks about the domestic violence on women. And it's not only about the white torture or the violence perpetrated by the white people, it's also about the domestic violence. So in a way, the later narratives of Australian Aboriginal women writers also open up a new dimension of endangerment, a new dimension of threat, a new dimension of identity crisis. Kim Scott is a major author, in fact, a major contemporary Australian Aboriginal writer. And Kim Scott's Benang from the Heart, I hope, is there prescribed in almost all the major universities. 1999, it was published in 1999, and it unveils the very dark Western, a very dark chapter in the Western Australian history, how a family was following the official assimilation policy, and how the great grandfather, Ernest Solomon Scott, was actually experimenting in a biological way. How to dilute the color of the skin, how to dilute the strain, dilute the color, how to make black white, a very ridiculously absurd kind of experimentation. And white men married several generations of Noongar women. And through marriage, Scott describes how the social and psychological repercussions of breeding out the color, how the next generation, the Huffies, the half generation, the stolen generation, the children born out of this, pseudo-scientific experimentation, had to bear the brunt of this experimentation, of this cruel practice, and how they were completely deracinated, how they were suffering from a continual dilemma, a very problematic identity. In fact, marginalized identities, once again, are a part of what we call the endangered status of the Aborigines. And Mudruru shares the horrible experiences of growing up with Aboriginal kids in school and facing the police persecution. Roberta Sykes's novel, Snake Cradle, 1997, records a very horrendous experience of her gang rape by four white men at the age of 17, and a very disturbing narrative indeed. And the white authors assuming fake Aboriginal identity for publicity. This is another aberration which we find in contemporary white Australian politics with Aboriginal representations. And how Anita Heiss, contemporary Aboriginal poet, deplored the fraud in her poem, Leon Carmen, a white Australian author who assumed fake Aboriginal identity. In fact, Aboriginal authors are compelled to write for the governor's pleasure, and they are compelled to reflect on their cultural subordination. There is no equitable cross-cultural dialogue. So we find it there, the entire situation of endangerment, cultural, religious, linguistic, and many other dimensions of endangerment experienced by the Aboriginal people of Australia. In fact, I have given a list of a few languages. There are many hundreds of languages which have become extinct in Australia because of the non-recognition and because of a kind of forced cultural amnesia initiated by the white Australian government. And you would find how there had been one or two speakers found in 1981, and no more. There are no speakers left now, and all these languages have died. And in this connection, I would like to continue my discussion with relation to the Indian indigenous situation. And it's really a very broad area, and it's really not possible to do justice to this area within, say, a deliberation within a talk of 1 hour. So it needs much more time. And but I have attempted to, in a way, showcase the highlights, the most salient features of the continuity of the convergences, which we can discover if we read closely the two continental productions of literature, of literary writings, okay, by the Australian Aborigines and by the Indian indigenous authors. In fact, if you look at the Northeast tribal situation in the Indian context, you would find there is a similar sense of disconnect from the ancestral culture as an impact of, you know, colonialism, okay, the British colonialism here, and how they had to embrace a new language, okay, the colonizers' language, and a new religion, that is Christianity. Okay, and if you read the history of the Northeast, okay, you would find how the British colonizers and then the American missionaries, okay, left behind the converted people, okay, the converted people who were trapped between two worlds, okay, and how they became skeptical of their indigenous identity. So how there had been a kind of linguistic aphasia, you know, generated by a long period of cultural domination, you know, by the outsiders, by the alien people. No, and how the Nagas, you know, they are separated. They belong to divergent groups. They are divided into many communities, and they are found in Nagaland, Arunachal Pradesh, and many other, you know, neighboring areas. So Nagas were segregated. They segregated themselves from the mainland India, and the idea of Benedict Anderson, once again, of imagined community. Okay, that we can also think of, you know, in the case of the Nagas, as we found it in the case of the Australian Aborigines. Okay, there were initially no inherent unities of the Naga tribes. Okay, but due to the continuous exposure of Western domination, and later also a continuous neglect of the Indian state. Okay, how the colonizing experience, okay, during the colonial period and also in the post-colonial period, how there had been a renewed attempt on the part of the Naga authors and intellectuals, you know, Naga people, to decolonize the colonial and the post-colonial contexts, okay, and to reassert, you know, and in a way to reformulate, you know, the Nagas as an imagined community, and how the autoethnography by the Naga intellectuals, by Naga authors, you know, tribes of Northeast, you know, created a renewed interest in their own oral traditions. And autoethnography of Naga scholars to reclaim identity. And I hope you have come across Jasmine Patton's A Girl Swallowed by a Tree, Lotha Naga Tales Retold. It was published in 2018, a very recent publication, and how she attempted to record, you know, oral literature, the oral narratives of the Lotha Nagas, and how it had been a very, you know, uncharacteristic and in a way revolutionary way of, you know, recapturing the indigenous experience of the Lotha Nagas, and how she represented in the mainstream literary scenario in her own inimitable way of, you know, by representing the indigenous identity, the indigenous culture. So Istarin Kire, Jasmine Patton, Temsulao, and many others, you know, challenged the colonial stereotype of the Nagas as the wild savages. You know, similar thing happened in the case of the Australian Aborigines too. And how the Nagas had also been the victim of linguistic imperialism, how the geographical divide of different Naga groups, Naga clans, Naga sects, okay, weakened the cultural affiliations. and how, you know, people who spoke English, okay, found favor, as I have been mentioning in the case of the new generation of the Australian Aborigines as well, how the social structure changed and how the teaching generation and learning generation were not in harmony with each other anymore. The Christian mission was responsible for the decay of the Morang culture, the Naga Morang culture. And in fact, we could also think of, you know, this endangered Naga identity from the Orientalist perspective as well. It can also be a kind of reference point where we find the rancor of Orient turns to hate against the Occident and the white man. How the Naga warrior tribes, you know, resisted, you know, actively resisted the British soldiers. How the British force used brute force, you know, to contain the Angami Nagas. How we find the white man, okay, was developed as an idea to subjugate the non-whites. The whole history of subjugation, okay, and marginalization of domination. So if we look at the Indian situation and if we go by the UNESCO list, we find that there are, you know, out of the 6,000 languages, roughly 6,000 languages in the world, 2,500 are already endangered. India tops the list with 196 languages. And I have given here the several categories of endangerment, definitely endangered, severely endangered, critically endangered, and also extinct languages. So in a way, we find that it's a very sad story and a very alarming prospect, the way we are losing languages. I have projected in this slide a Pottochitro. It is borrowed from the Potuas of Pingla division. It is Noya village of Pingla block. It is it's a macher pot. It's a pot of fish, and how this scroll painting shows us how the big fish, you know, gobbles up the small fishes. Matsunnai, we call it, and look, the big fish is equivalent to the big language, the killer language, and how it kills the smaller languages. So it's a very precarious position in the language politics of the 21st century. We find the minority languages are on the vanguard of a cultural amnesia, ushered in by the majority languages, and how the Marga tradition, the colonial tradition, actually decimated the prospect of the Desi or the Bhasha, you know, languages, the Bhashas, and how, we find the advent of the print culture completely decimated the long tradition, the ancient tradition of the oral cultures, the oral traditions. Since the time of Sir William Jones, Western cognitive categories, okay, had been applied, so oral communities were excluded. And we find the monolingual texts were preferred over the multilingual ones. And this had been the tradition also in the Indian subcontinent, how the subnational or regional languages, like Bangla, like Oshomiya and many others, they expect migration of smaller language communities. And these smaller languages, these minor languages are actually the languages of the indigenous communities, the tribal languages, as a result of development, while regional languages feel uneasy in the face of mega languages, mega languages like English and Hindi. The hierarchy of fear and anxiety in all languages of the world. So in the 21st century, we find that there is a very rapid decline of natural languages. And I'm just scrolling the slides because I don't have time. I think I have almost exhausted the time allotted to me. So if you look at the census, you would find the figures. In 1961, it was 1652. In 1971, it was drastically reduced to 108. And the 109th slot, reserved for all other languages. And these were mostly the languages of the central and the western part of India, the Chotanagpur Plateau and the western part of India. If you imagine 100 kilometers north and south of the Surat Howrah railway line, you find how eastern Gujarat, Chhattisgarh, Odisha, West Bengal and South Bihar, accommodate a large number of indigenous communities. with their own vibrant cultural traditions, with their own language practices, with their own linguistic communities. But these small language communities of different families, okay, were completely ignored, not only during the colonial times, but also in the post-colonial era. So we find that during the first linguistic survey by George Abraham Grierson, okay, many indigenous languages were not recognized. Okay, they were de-recognized as simply the variations of some state language, and how it was reported that they have lost their languages. And we find that English is a killer language. It destroyed indigenous languages in Canada, USA, Australia, and New Zealand. Okay. We have just discussed the condition of the Aboriginal languages in Australia, where they used 27 local languages. Now they are allowed to use only Australian Aboriginal English. In India, greater number of tribal languages are still in use, but they are eclipsed by Hindi, English, and other state languages. Very little translation work is found, especially in the central and western parts of the Indian subcontinent. So there are different causes for this endangerment. We find that 310 languages, 263 spoken by less than 5 people, and 47 by less than 1,000 are also nearing extinction. So we are losing languages, and if Bhashas die at this rate, it is estimated that over the next 50 years, we will see the extinction of most of the Bhashas spoken by the nomadic communities and Adivasis, just as we all witness a large-scale erosion of some of the main Bhashas that have a rich history of written literature. So, in fact, we find that there is a very rich collection of nomadic literature, especially autobiographies by the nomadic people. Okay, literature of the DNT from Marathi to English. We have found some autobiographies by Kishore Shantabai Kale, Lakshman Mane, Atmaram Rathod, and Lakshman Gaikwad. And if you read these autobiographies by these criminal tribes and the nomadic tribes, we'll find there is a stunning similarity in terms of their experience of pain and suffering, experience of humiliation, experience of torture and marginalization, stunning similarity to the experiences of Aboriginal autobiographies, the pains of being imprisoned, the pains of suffering, the pains of police atrocities, and many other allied experiences. So in a way, we find it in a state language like Marathi, but look here that these nomadic authors represent their own language communities. Banjaras have their own language tradition. Kaikadis have their own language tradition. But they cannot, in a way, write in their own mother tongue, because there are no takers. There is no prospect of publication. So their mother tongue is threatened. It is endangered. So they have to write either in Marathi or in Hindi. Otherwise, they won't be able to express themselves. So there is a kind of, severe, linguistic handicap, particularly for the writers, for the authors of the minor languages. So it has created, a situation of endangerment, which is increasing every day, which is getting more alarming every day. And in the 21st century, by 2050, there is a possibility that most of these languages of the nomadic tribes might be extinct, due to this constant non-recognition, by the official language policy. So in a way, this was my submission, because I think that I have exhausted my time of presentation. Anyway, now thank you for your patient hearing, and I had a number of slides left because I had planned, in fact, a comprehensive and inclusive kind of highlights of the research that we have conducted over the last 12 to 13 years. In fact, I in the latter slides, I had also included the different language, minor language communities, mostly indigenous language communities, whom we had identified during our People's Linguistic Survey of India, and how we have traced their geographical locations, their cultural traditions, their oral performative traditions, and how some samples of contemporary writings by some of the people who are literate and educated in the by the Indian education system. So in a way, we have been able to identify several such groups in the Indian context, but we feel that we have miles to go. We feel that there is a need to do further research on each and every minor language community. In fact, there is a need to record and archive the oral and also written literary traditions of these minor language communities. In fact, we have a lot of work to do in this regard. Anyway, so this is my submission to the esteemed audience, and I hope that my lecture somehow could bring into focus the plight of the Aboriginal authors in the Australian context, and some of the Indigenous authors in the Indian context. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Acharya. This has been an extremely illuminating discussion on the condition of the cultural identity crisis, language crisis, ethnic crisis of the two communities who are probably separated by an ocean, but their identity crises are more or less the crises are more or less the same. And I'd now like to invite questions from the audience. If there are questions from the audience.
Ma'am, they are posting questions on the chat.
I'm not sure how to access those on the chat. Let me try. Right, so the questions are all here. Then the first question is from Madhuri Rana. Why do our syllabuses in colleges and universities do not include much of the Aboriginal writing?
Thank you, Madhuri, for your question. In fact, there are some universities in India which have already included Aboriginal writings in their syllabus. I can distinctly remember some of the universities like the University of Delhi, Jawaharlal Nehru University, and other premier universities. In fact, Australian Aboriginal writing had also been in the syllabus of Jadavpur University English department. I know that. In fact, I know in JNU, when I had been conducting my UGC minor research project, say in 2007, when I had been to JNU, you know, I met Professor Santosh Sarin there, who had already been doing research on Australian Aboriginal writing, and who had already come up with an anthology of Australian Aboriginal literature, okay, by 1997. So, in a way, the premier universities of India had already introduced, you know, Australian Aboriginal literature in their syllabus. And in some of the regional universities also, some of the universities in the rural and, you know, municipal areas, we have also found that Australian Aboriginal literature has made its way, particularly due to the initiative of the Australia-India Council. In fact, Australia-India Council research grant was made available to many university departments. And I can distinctly recall one university of West Bengal, the University of Burdwan, Burdwan University, okay, which already has one center for Australian studies. And there had been a number of scholars from this university who have been to Australia for their doctoral research, okay, under the supervision of there are very dynamic professor there, who is now a vice chancellor of Bankura University, Professor Debnaran Bandopadhyay. Okay, I know how Debnaran Babu has encouraged, okay, many scholars to take up Australian Aboriginal literature for their research work, and how many of them have visited Australia in connection with their research work. So in a way, it's catching up. You know, Australian Aboriginal texts have become part of the syllabus in some of the universities. But I acknowledge, I admit that, you know, many other universities should take up, you know, Australian Aboriginal literature as, you know, a kind of optional course, or maybe as part of a core course on, you know, Aboriginal studies or Indigenous studies. And I think the universities, especially the central universities, which have now come up with a Center for Endangered Languages and Cultures, should also think of introducing, you know, Australian Aboriginal language and literature as a kind of, you know, comparative study. As a kind of comparative study, because that will enrich the study of Indian indigenous language and literature as well. Thank you for your question.
She has another question, Professor Acharya. She asks, what is the condition of the Aboriginal people in Bengal? And what is the government doing for the inclusion of their culture and language?
Yes, that is another very important question. In fact, in Bengal, you know, before 2003, there had been, in a way, no official recognition of any particular, you know, indigenous language. Okay, if we think of Nepali, that is an exception. But barring Nepali, if you think of the language communities, the indigenous language communities of the eastern part of India, and also the central part of India, the tribal communities of the Chotanagpur Plateau, if you take them into consideration, there had been no recognition of any such community, say, up to 2003 in Bengal. In 2003, when Santali was officially included in the 8th schedule of Indian Constitution, when it became a constitutional language, only then, you know, Santali language and literature was officially recognized in Bengal. And in Bengal, say up to 2014, we find that the study of Santali at the school, college, and university level, okay, had been prevalent. But there had been no recognition for other tribal languages and literatures. It was primarily due to our sustained effort through the People's Linguistic Survey of India that 2015 onwards, the government of West Bengal has recognized a number of indigenous languages. Okay. And the languages like, you know, Kuduk, Rajbangshi, you know, Kamtapuri, Kudmali, okay, such languages have now been recognized by the government of West Bengal. Okay. On 21st February 2019, the Chief Minister had declared the inclusion of two more languages. Okay, that was Kuduk and Kudmali. Okay, and Kuduk Academy and Kudmali Academy had already been established in West Bengal. So, in a way, it had been a very recent development, but due to the sustained effort, okay, on the part of the researchers to identify and reclaim the language rights of the indigenous communities, we find that the government has finally approved, okay, some of the languages. Okay, we have miles to go, but the beginning is quite encouraging. You know, we are quite optimistic that some of the languages have at least been given recognition in West Bengal.
There is another participant, his full name is not there, it's just RLM. And he asked this question that you have rightfully mentioned that Grierson's survey sealed the fate of many tribal linguistic groups in Northeast India. And he's asking this question, is there a procedure to undo it now?
There is definitely a procedure to undo, because if you look at the history of People's Linguistic Survey of India, you will find that the very principle of operation of this linguistic survey is based on the idea of decolonization. That decolonizing the colonial process of knowledge production. In fact, Grierson's linguistic survey had been a glorious example of colonial production of knowledge. And there had been a persistent attempt on the part of the white colonizers to create, you know, new knowledge, quote unquote, for the colonized people, as if the colonized people were ahistorical beings. They didn't have there any history of their own. So there was an attempt to create a new history of the colonized people. So Grierson's linguistic survey was a similar attempt to create a new linguistic history of the colonized people. That is why he could exclude so many languages in order to give preference to a monolingual administrative framework, in order to make one state language as the language of administration. Okay. But that definitely took away the linguistic human rights of hundreds of minor language communities. So there is definitely an attempt, or there had been definitely an attempt 2010 onwards through a new linguistic survey of India, People's Linguistic Survey of India, where, you know, we find the process of indigenous ethnography has been followed. Okay, where the community member, the tribal scholar, is the ethnographer. Okay, he is the first documenter of his or her own language and literary traditions. So it begins from a point where people are going to document their own language. Okay. So it is just the reverse of Grierson's policy of documentation. And I think that that is the most effective way to undo this historical wrong. Okay, this historical wrong, and thereby to create a more inclusive way of representing the linguistic identity of the indigenous communities.
So there is Dr. Dechen Doma Sherpa. His question is, the loss of indigenous languages has definitely damaged the culture and literature of these indigenous peoples. So what is your reflections on the role of translation of those writings? Would it be a boon or a bane in the context of indigenous writing? He means translation.
Yes, yes. So that is definitely a very significant question, and that is definitely a very problematic question as well. Because, you know, translation is like a two-way sword. Translation inherently implies representation. Now, it is a representation of the source culture in the target culture. Now, the role of the translator is very important. The politics of translation is very important. What the translator is supposed to translate, who the translator is translating, what cultural contexts, what cultural heritage the translator is supposed to translate, how effective is the linguistic equipment of the translator to effectively translate the cultural nuances of the source culture, of the source language. Okay, so there are many such questions, okay, which are important and which inevitably crop up, okay, when we think of translating, okay, the literary traditions of indigenous languages. Yes, I agree with you that this is a problematic area, but I would also suggest that translation is a very necessary kind of exercise. Okay, it can misrepresent, no, underrepresent, overrepresent, but at the same time, it represents. Translation has the power of representation. And we have to acknowledge one thing, that in the globalized era of the 21st century, in the increasingly monolingual cultural setup of the 21st century, in the increasingly language dominance theory of the 21st century, we find that some languages are preferred over others, and translation into some mega languages, quote unquote, okay, are essential for the self-representation of many, quote unquote, minor indigenous language and literature communities. Okay, so, but I always think that if the scholar from the community, if the scholar belongs to the community, and if the scholar can bridge the two languages, his or her own mother tongue and the language in which he or she is going to translate, if the documenter and the translator are the same person, if he or she has the same linguistic capacity in terms of language mastery, in terms of both the source language and the target language, okay, I think that can be an ideal situation in which the cultural nuances of the source culture, okay, can be effectively translated into the target language. For example, you know, what is happening in the northeastern, you know, indigenous literary situation. Okay, for example, authors like Temsula Ao, like Mamang Dai, you know, like, you know, Jasmine Patton, like Isterin Kire. Okay, if you look at them, you would find that, okay, they were able to, in a way, synthesize, you know, their experience of their own, you know, Naga identity, and their exposure to Western education and their complete mastery over the English language. So if there is this kind of, you know, a syncretic intellectual tradition where they can effectively synthesize the different language and cultural practices, if the individuals can do that from the community, okay, that can be, I think, the most optimistic situation for the cultural translation of indigenous literature.
And I must ask Vrindan how much time we have and how many questions we may take.
Ma'am, one more.
One more?
Yeah.
Okay, all right, thank you. So Okay. So there is a question on the performative aspects of indigenous writing. This is from Vrinda, and she requests Professor Acharya to discuss the performative aspects of indigenous writing.
Yes, performative aspects of indigenous writing are quite obvious, because each and every indigenous writing is a kind of performance because of its, you know, essential orality. In fact, if you read, you know, Jasmine Patton's, you know, work that I have mentioned, A Little Girl, you know, Swallowed by a Tree, okay, Lotha Naga Tales Retold, okay, if you read the text, okay, you will find, okay, how the narrative itself is a kind of, you know, retelling of an oral narration by a community elder. So the writing itself is a record of an essentially oral communication of one cultural situation. And if you look at the, you know, recorded texts of the Australian Aboriginal authors like Paddy Rowe, you know, I mentioned the text, you know, Gularabulu, which was published in 1983. If you read Gularabulu, you will find that this is essentially, okay, written in the form of a dialogue where, you know, two Aboriginal people are interacting with each other, and it's a very lively, okay, conversation in which they even quarrel and disagree and create, you know, a kind of heated situation, okay, whereby they constantly refute each other's point of view. Okay. But the entire text is conceived in the form of a dialogue. Okay, it's a series of dialogue, okay, often interspersed with brilliant repartees, okay, indigenous flashes of indigenous wisdom, you know, folk wisdom. So if you read such a text, okay, you will feel every moment, okay, how the entire text is conceived in the idea of performativity, okay, how the participants are performers, how the text is a recorded version of a series of performances. Okay. It is apparent in any you know, text, literary text by any Australian Aboriginal author.
I'm really sorry about not being able to pose the rest of the questions to Professor Acharya, but I think Mr. Rindan Kundu has a way out for that, and he'll announce that after I sum up. Thank you very much, participants, for your questions. Extremely enlightening and important questions that you asked. Now, I'd now like to sum up the whole talk when we are in view of the Australian Aboriginal writing and Indian Indigenous literature. So these two communities, as Professor Acharya mentioned, they have a special focus in his talk from the historical and literary perspectives. Both the communities have hitherto been misrepresented or underrepresented in the mainstream literature. These writers share the same objectives in writing their life to disseminate information about their difficult journey due to marginalization, to assert their rights, to exhibit their sustained effort to reclaim their dignity and identity, and to spread the message of hope. However, even if there is a remarkable homogeneity between the Dalit writing and the Aboriginal communities' writing, there is a distinction between their ethos, their ethnicity, and their everyday predicaments, and their prospects in life and living. There is extensive research that Professor Acharya has conducted, and he has presented here for all our benefit. He has focused on tracing the similarities between these communities despite their dissimilarities. There are core similarities, and there is no denying the fact that there are many divergences and convergences in these two, their two domains of writing. And as he suggested, through the questions and through his talk, more research is required if widespread literary awakening and the attempt to rewrite their histories should happen for their benefit and for the benefit of the larger community, world communities. They have been tortured, they have been marginalized, and there have been attempts to eliminate both their culture and their language. It's time that more of their literature should come up, and more of research and more of inclusiveness should there be in our dealings with us, so that we can feel included in their culture as well. It's not that we have to include them, but we must feel included in their cultures, in their writing. Thank you very much, Dr. Acharya, for your invaluable discourse and your illuminating talk on the lecture on using the research that you have done. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Samantha. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. I am extremely grateful to Professor Indranil Acharya for accepting my invitation. I hope that we will have you in our beautiful campus soon. Thank you, Professor Kalani Samantharaya, for chairing this session. I thank all my colleagues, students, and all the respected participants for showing interest in this webinar series. The last talk of this World Literature Series will be on 16th. We'll see you on Sunday. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Rindan.
Thank you, ma'am.